Town, the hub of the Orient, is strategically situated at the junction of international trade routes, where the itinerant peoples of two hemispheres vie with each other commercially and socially in settings that are Chinese by tradition and British by possession. Less than 100 years ago, a few British ships dropped anchor in this harbor and endeavored to negotiate trade with China, the so-called Celestial Kingdom, which had persistently refused to open its gates to the outside world. Peaceful negotiations proving in vain, a war followed, and as a result, Great Britain received an indemnity of $6 million on the island of Hong Kong, which is now a most important link in the world's greatest chain of empire. Before the arrival of the British, Hong Kong was a desolate island infested with pirates and smugglers and overrun with pestilence. Under Great Britain's rule, it has been miraculously transformed into one of the greatest seaports in the world, through which passes about $1 billion worth of shipping every year. Ships from all parts of the world sail in and out of this harbor at regular intervals, but in spite of the modern craft, the poor Chinese families cling to their junks and sampans, as they have been doing for centuries, completely indifferent to the innovations of time and progress. The story is told that in former days, little boys were carefully tied to the sampans, while little girls were allowed to run free, the conclusion being that if a girl baby fell overboard and was drowned, it wouldn't make much difference. Thanks to British influence, however, this cruel custom is no longer practiced. The whole gamut of human life is often passed upon these sampans, birth, marriage, and death, within sight of land, but seldom on land. A bowl of rice and a fish constituting a diet that varies but little all through life. But with it all, there seems to be a general atmosphere of domestic peace and contentment. We are told that in the harbor of Hong Kong alone, over 30,000 Chinese families live on these boats, a floating city inhabited by the descendants of the original settlers, as if they were literally pushed off the island, but lingered about to witness the transformation of Hong Kong from a barren rock into one of the most modern and up-to-date colonies in the world. Fish is one of the chief foods among the natives, and consequently it forms an important local industry. A species similar to white bait being in conspicuous evidence along the waterfront. This fish is used as an ingredient in a special dish composed of rice, duck, chestnuts, noodles, and bamboo sprouts, usually served at important social functions. Sampan life is not a lazy one, for everybody seems to be occupied. The men do a reasonable amount of work, but the women appear to be the most industrious. They clean the boats, mend clothes, care for the children, cook meals, and lug loads from morning until night. Although the outside world thinks of Hong Kong as an entity which comprises harbors, cities, and all that goes with the Crown Colony, there is really no such thing as the city of Hong Kong. The city and port is Victoria, so called in honor of Queen Victoria, who made the island a Crown Colony. Along the Bund or waterfront, the international pageant of Victoria is at its best, for here passes in the course of an hour representatives of practically every race, creed, and color in the world. The tall men with the white turbans are Sikhs from India, originally imported by the British to guide the destinies of the local police force. The island of Hong Kong has been westernized considerably by British influence, particularly in the capital city of Victoria, where modern architecture and modern business are in vogue. But beyond the western front is the typical and proverbial life of Hong Kong, still clinging tenaciously to the unchanging manners and customs of ancient China. In the Chinese section of Hong Kong, it is estimated that there are 150,000 people living and doing business on an area smaller than 160 acres of farmland, thereby making it the most densely populated section in the world. Thank you. Not far from the busy marts of trade and traffic is the picturesque and restful pleasure resort of Hong Kong, known as Repulse Bay. Years ago, Chinese pirates were repulsed in this bay, hence the strange name that it bears today. This colorful resort is a rendezvous for the socially elite of Hong Kong, as well as for visitors from all parts of the world. It is particularly noted for the beautiful Chinese girls who are in conspicuous evidence during the social season. In addition to its colorful and ultra-modern bathing pavilion, Hong Kong proudly calls attention to its Repulse Bay Hotel, one of the world's famous hostelries where the East meets the West in a convivial spirit of pleasure and good fellowship. Although many of these beautiful Chinese girls have been educated in Occidental institutions and speak other languages besides their own, they seem to prefer the ancient dress of China to the innovations of Western styles. And after looking at a few of them, we are inclined to feel that they are right in their preference. Nevertheless, their schooling abroad has contributed largely to the liberation of Chinese women, which is now in gradual progress throughout all of China. And it is here that we have the pleasure of meeting Miss Hong Kong, who is regarded as the island's most beautiful Chinese girl. And now, with the exotic smile of Miss Hong Kong and the picturesque impressions of the island she symbolizes indelibly fixed in our memories, it is time for us to conclude our visit and reluctantly say farewell to Hong Kong, the hub of the Orient.